So you meet with the doctor. Now we're in this place. Now let's talk about this before we jump to the superstar and the fame and all that. That's we both know a little bit about that stuff. Let's talk about this. Let's talk about the times you felt like quitting. And the reason I want to talk about that is because there's a mailman out there. There's a FedEx guy out there. There's a guy working at the post office. There's a guy that drives buses. There's a truck driver somewhere driving cross country. He's exhausted. He's popping no-dos and 5-hour energy drinks just to stay alive and stay awake so he can feed his kids. There's people out there in the world that got real jobs that are even, you know, different from our lives. Like, you know, we live different lives, but we live lives that are really different from probably most Americans on certain levels.
Yeah.
So tell me about... You know, and how deep you go is up to you. But tell me about the times you felt like quitting and what you did to continue on. Like, you talked about that little spark of light. Let's talk about the times you felt like quitting.
Well, that was often. But I know that, it was a lot. Feel like quitting moments. The one that sticks out to me the most is when I did something really stupid because I was signed with the Bass Brothers when I was like 15 years old, right? And they had connections with Elektra Records because I forgot.
Tell everybody who the Bass Brothers are so they...
The Bass Brothers, FBT Productions, were actually the first guys to sign me because they had some kind of connection with Elektra Records at the time, right? And so me and the guys from my group Basement Productions, we made like a demo, and they gave it to, we recorded in their studio. They had signed me to a contract, and we recorded at their studio, and the Elektra ended up turning it down and saying that I was too young, you know, like, you hit us up when he gets older or something.
Really?
Yeah.
That's interesting.
So it basically fell through, and I kept going, still kept going. And then when I started getting into the battle scene and stuff, the Bass Brothers approached me again. They had heard about what I was doing. They wanted to meet with me and shit, and they heard what I was doing around the city and stuff.
They believed in you.
Yeah. Yep. So now they got a connection, they said, with Loud Records. So I forgot the dude. I can't remember the guy's name.
Yeah, I was involved at that point, too.
Okay,
So that we were talking to one of the A&R guys. It was,
so you weren't talking to Steve, you were talking to somebody?
No, somebody else. Should we put him
Bigger
on
B?
I don't want to put him on blast.
I don't think it matters.
That doesn't matter. It was just one of the A&R guys.
Okay, so let's talk about, he was a non-believer?
No. He was all in.
He was all in?
Yeah.
Well, then if he was all in, then let's talk about it. Like, who was it? If he was all in, then he was on the right side of history, I think.
Yeah, it was Shane Mooney.
Okay, Shane Mooney.
Okay, so we're making, I'm recording these records, and literally the day I'm recording, there's a song on my first album called Rock Bottom, and I'm recording that song, and Marky, one of the guys from Bass Brothers, they're brothers, they're twin brothers or whatever, or not twins. No. But they look like twins.
They're just brothers.
Okay. So
they're brothers with a strong resemblance.
Yeah. So these two guys, so Marky comes in and he's like, yo, I can't remember how he said it, but he was like, Shane works in the mailroom at Loud.
Yeah, that wasn't true though.
It wasn't?
No, he was A&R.
Oh, okay. Cause that's what they had told me.
I think they were upset because it turned out they weren't going to put a deal on the table, so they were just making it all bad. Yeah.
Okay. So that didn't go through, and what that led to you feeling what?
It's right around the time that I started messing with any kind of drugs, and I probably took 25 codeine pills. And was like, fuck it.
Oh, you tried to finish yourself.
Yeah, and I don't know if I was, I was just so depressed. Mm-hmm. I was like, man, fuck it. And I ended up throwing up all over I missed the toilet at Marky's house. And puked all over the fucking floor and was like, just laying there for like 30 minutes. Like, they came in there, they're like, yo, I'm like, I can't get up. Just let me lay here for a second. And it just made me start thinking about my life. Like, what the fuck am I doing?
Mm-hmm.
And at that, because at that moment, that was the last any kind of ray of hope we had, mm-hmm. that I had.
Mm-hmm.
And when mm-hmm. they told me he worked in the mailroom and that he didn't have any juice there, I was like, I don't know, that was like the rock bottom
mm-hmm.
point. Mm-hmm. And it was just so crazy that I felt that way while I was recording the song, because the song is basically about that.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah, I don't know. I don't think I was trying to off myself. I think I was just trying to get really super high.
And numb the pain. And,
yeah. But I took a lot of pills. I don't remember exactly how many, but I took way too many and puked.
Mm-hmm. But you see, the thing about it, I think that's important for people that are listening. Once again, it's LL Cool J, Rock the Bells Radio. Me and DJ Z Trip, influencer hip hop on Rock the Bells. We're talking to Eminem. I think the thing that's important to remember is that everybody has dark periods. Yeah. I had dark periods. I had every label, you know, Sugar Hill and Joy, all the Tommy Boy. They all turned me down. They all sent letters to the house.
Wow.
They, you know, my mother would find me upstairs just like in a funk, like just, you know, devastated. And she'd look around the room and find like rejection letters and shit.
Yeah.
Like, you know, that she found. And she would be like, oh, Todd, don't worry about it. You're as good. You're better or as good as a lot of the guys on the radio. You'll be all right.
Yeah.
And I was like, oh, Mom, well, I don't have any equipment. This and that, I don't have this. And she took her tax return. It just so happened the timing. She got her tax return. She brought me 2 turntables and a mixer. And that's how I was, and a little other stuff. Yeah. A drum machine.
I know
a drum
this story, machine. Too.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. And it just changed my world. But so, okay, so you're on the floor. Give me 30 minutes. The world is falling to pieces. How did you keep going? How'd you keep going? How did you get up off the floor metaphorically and keep going on the journey?
Well, I remember feeling like I want to quit,
mm-hmm.
but lines just, you know, lines just hit you.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I'm saying? So I just would, I'm like, I don't think this is going to pan out, but I'm still thinking of lines,
mm-hmm.
you know, and I'm writing them down. And if I ever get a chance to use them, like, and, I think that right around that time was when certain, just other things started falling into place. Like I was doing, at some point, it was definitely after this, but at some point I started doing shows around Detroit and actually getting paid for it.
Mm.
$50.
Mm-hmm.
But shit, $50 is $50.
Hell yeah.
So.
Shit.
So, you know, so that was one of the things that kind of kept me going a little bit.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah, again, you know the feeling when you get rejected.
It's the worst.
Devastation you can't even explain.
It's gutting.
Because you're just like, where's my life going?
Right. And and it makes you feel absolutely worthless.
Yeah.
Because it makes you feel like you're delusional in a bad way.
Yeah, you're not good enough.
Yeah, yeah. Exactly.
Yeah.
So, once again, it's LL Cool J, Rock the Bells Radio, my man DJ Z Trip, the influencer of hip-hop. We're in the building. My man Eminem is in the building. In the background, aiding and abetting, we have Alchemist and Paul Rosenberg in the building. He's on his phone heavy, doing a lot of typing.
Trying to double duty here to get work done. Only so many hours in the day.
No doubt. No doubt about it.
Yeah, he's a Def Jam now.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. That's a, you know what? We got to talk about that in a minute, too, because that's some dope shit.
Yeah, that could be a whole nother show.
You know what? Maybe it needs to be.
Okay.
It needs to be.
Okay.
It needs to be. We need to do a Def Jam oriented show with you and talk about the history of the label. I'll tell you some things. I know you tell me some things about the new shit.
Okay.
We get into that. Yeah, we're going to do that. That's good.
Paul is blowing up, by the way, right now, because he's doing photo shoots and shit now, too. Like, he's now he's got interviews. This is what I'm talking about.
Just trying to be like you guys.
I got
to
tell you, Paul, pick up your fucking phone. Had to be the funniest shit in the history of America on Twitter. Paul, pick up your fucking phone.
That's so funny that you saw that. Look, man, I'm new in this Twitter game, okay?
20 million people saw that.
But I'm going to tell you this much. I think I'm doing a hell of a job right now.
You're doing a fucking hell of a job. Paul, pick up your fucking phone on Twitter.
That's keeping it 100,
That's
100 right there.
I was fucking laughing. But I love that shit. Because I could feel that I felt like you had tried him like 10 times. And he's busy, obviously. So, you know, it was some shit.
He was doing a photo shoot.
That's funny.
He was doing an interview with LL Cool J.
He's getting good at the Instagram, though, but every time he picks up his phone to take a picture, I have to show him how to actually, which button to push to take the picture.
And I take some dope-ass pictures.
Yeah, did you, I thought I saw something, you had a picture with Smokey Robinson or something like that? Yeah. That's fucking...
That one didn't turn out that good, the selfie.
Yeah. But,
I mean...
Which one did? Yeah.
I think the one me and Mr. Porter and Al getting ready for Coachella.
Oh, okay.
That was a good one.
Right.
Good shit. Cinematic.